Hello and welcome to Skeptics in the Pub. We're here to hear about anarchy and radicals and quantum physics. That's right. Michael Brooks is going to talk to us about his latest book that combines all of these crazy ideas into one scientific approach to quantum physics.
Scientists are kind of dealing with stuff that they think is true. They're not sure it's true. Other people are standing against them and railing against them. And sometimes there are casualties. This is Goethe, who said, daring ideas are like chessmen moved forward. They may be beaten, but they may start a winning game.
Hello, Michael. Thank you for taking some time out to talk about your new book, The Edge of Uncertainty. And can you tell us a bit about it?
Well, it's about the things that scientists are doing right at the cutting edge, things they're not even sure they're on the right track, but just seem like the right way to go. So it's kind of working at the very limits of what we know.
Ilya Ivan Ivanovich, there we are, that's him, who was another fine-looking guy. There's so many beards in this thing tonight. So he was actually the chief artificial inseminator to the imperial court of Russia. To the animals of the imperial court of Russia. He was the best artificial inseminator in the world during his time, which is not a claim that many people have been able to make through history. He was really good at it, and he was so good at it that actually he started sort of getting ideas above his station, as it were. And he decided in about, I think it was 1910, this is when he announced it, at the International Zoology Conference, that he decided it was a good time to start talking about crossing apes with humans.
Yeah, I'd like to know a little bit more about these mad scientists you talk about. Can you cite some examples in what they've done?
Well, there's a guy up in Nottingham called David Pritchard who sort of infects himself with hookworms to find out what they do. Another self-infector is a guy called Barry Marshall in Australia who swallowed a cup full of bacteria in order to prove that these bacteria were creating stomach ulcers. Other people just kind of get into fights or fudge their data because they think they're right, and turns out sometimes they are. And Isaac Newton was one of those.
Now, Darwin was well aware of animal personalities. He had interesting things to say about it. In fact, he observed a dog that he knew that would always go and lick a cat as it walked past him, and the cat was asleep. It was just, these sort of signs of affection. And he said, he'd seen cows show affection to one another, and he said that he had a friend of his who knew of a bunch of crows where three of the crows were blind, and one of the other crows would always feed them their food. You sort of see this kind of sense of affection and caring.
So we anthropomorphize animals. We see them having sort of similar traits to us in many ways. Any dog owner knows that their dog has a personality, and it's different to the personality that their next door neighbor's dog has. Science is just kind of catching up with this now, because for a long time, for decades, scientists refused to have anything to do with this kind of stuff because they felt it wasn't scientific enough. But now, it's just starting to become acceptable now to talk about animal personalities. And a lot of scientists still call them behavioral syndromes, but what they actually mean is personality. So science is catching up there, actually, with what we kind of always thought to be the case. Even Darwin thought this.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us. It's been really great. And I hope you sell lots and lots of books, which are, I believe it's coming out in...
It'll be out in the summer. Yeah. So hopefully I will sell lots.
Great. Thank you very much.